Before I start, I'd like to thank Professor Duncan organizing this meeting and inviting me to present a talk based upon my recent publication, which appeared in this journal only a few weeks ago. My title of talk is Theory of Bose-Einstein Condensation Nuclear Fusion. And so I will be talking about Bose-Einstein condensation quite often. Okay. This is just outline of my talk. The entire controversy started with this knowledge from nuclear physics in conventional nuclear physics from beam experiment, which is plotted here. These two channels had this type of data. And one can fit experimental data below 100 kV by using this formula. And this formula contains so-called gamma factor. The fit is so beautiful that we nuclear physicists believe this is a correct formula for the beam experiment. Now, for electrolysis and the gas loading experiment involving metal, reaction is going with these three reactions. But now, if you look at the reaction six, there is no gamma ray involved. And another thing you notice from previous speakers is that this channel is dominant from other two. Initial claim by the freshman Pons was indeed this reaction, and lots of controversy resulted because, first of all, Coulomb repulsion is somehow overcome, and this violates momentum conservation in free space, although this is not in a free space. And this is an attempt to criticize freshman Pond and the other experiment, because if you take a gamma factor and compute the gamma factor using appropriate energy, then you see numbers you would believe would be something like this number, whereas freshman Pond's number is this big. So the objection to their claim was this gamma factor. And this is sort of summary of what you heard earlier talk. Not complete, but I listed 10 of the experimental observation which any theory has to satisfy or explain. It's not a simple one or two effect. It's a many, many different observation is evolved over the 20 years. So this is sort of a brief summary of that observation. Obviously, it's not complete. But I'm going to address those 10 observation by theory. So the question is, can we assume a single concept, physical concept, and develop a theory which could explain all of these 10 observations? Key to this is deuteriums are mobile in the metal when electric current or heating is applied, as well as pressure gradients in gas loading experiment. So we will explore concept of a nuclear Bose-Einstein condensation for developing a consistent physical theory which could explain all the 310 observations. When you look at the Bose-Einstein condensation, what's happening here, I'm taking an example from atomic case. You have, as you cool your neutral atoms, the particle with a higher kinetic energy essentially go to a lower ground state. This is done by cooling mostly, but eventually at certain point, this condition is satisfied, so that it becomes Bose-Einstein condensation. And this was observed in 1995 by these two physicists as well as Kettler from MIT. So this is a very beautiful example of that experiment. As you cool down, you start seeing low energy or low velocity samples population sort of grows, and those condensates. They used the magnetic trap and laser beam to cool the atoms. Now, let's compare atomic Bose-Einstein condensation with the nuclear Bose-Einstein condensation. Remember, the condition one must satisfy is this condition here, where wavelength is given by this formula. And for atomic case, these distances are very large because they had a very low density system. So one must cool down to this velocity. And they did achieve that. And so essentially they achieved this by laser and evaporation cooling. Now for our nuclear Bose-Einstein condensation, deuterium in metal, assuming most of them are mobile, you have this density, and what we require is cooling down to this velocity from, let's say, room temperature. It's only different by a factor of two. So in a way, it's easier for us because this happens to be much, much smaller than atomic case. So there's a hope of achieving that. And there are flexibility for us. Either we can cool the system to make charged deuteron slow down, or we can use electromagnetic field to do it. That's one of the advantages, because in the atomic case, they had a neutral atom. So only way they can cool is just do the cooling, throwing down is done by cooling. Whereas we have charged deuterium in the metal, mobile, and by applying electromagnetic field, we'll be able to throw down. And another possibility is just simply compressing more to ultra high pressure using a device like a diamond anvil cell. This is quite a possibility. But for this field, probably this use of electromagnetic field is probably more appropriate. Now I'm going to describe, once Bose-Einstein state is achieved experimentally, what it does. One has to really develop a theory to see what the consequence of that is for in this field. So I'm going to describe the way we are computing. First of all, there are the ground state wave function one must to obtain from n-body Schrödinger equation, which is written here. And I exclude the electrons. It can be added as Coulomb, shielded Coulomb potential, but that's much easier problem than this bare Coulomb repulsion. So whatever we get this should be applicable to this as well. Now, because of time, I'm not going through all the derivations, but I note the published result. This is how we solved the Schrödinger equation, and incidentally, this was used for us by for the atomic Bose-Einstein case. So I'm just borrowing technique from atomic Bose-Einstein condensation law. And now, once you get the wave function, how you compute the reaction rate? And to do that, we use a two-potential formula, well-known two-potential formula for the scattering amplitude, and then we use a so-called optical theorem. This is very rigorous theorem, so but I'm put the approximation because we are making some approximation this side. But one can show that once you got the wave function, Coulomb wave function, no nuclear force involved, just purely Coulomb part, which is done here, and then of course to compute that you have to do this. And you can extract that one. So this works for two-body case in the free space, which we have done and published the paper, as well as this case as well, the n-body system. And this is just showing how the computation is done. Including a strong force, which is related to the S factor here. And formula looks like this. The rate can be written in this form. Once you get the wave function, we know what this is from previous slide, and we can just compute, since we have a wave function, one can compute this quantity and end up with this one. So this is the result. Very simple formula, bunch of constants, but they are all known constants. Only unknown constant is the probability of Bose-Einstein condensate ground state occupation. In the atomic case, it was 10%, but for our case, we don't know what percentage that would be. It could be order of 100th or 1,000th. We do not know. So this is one unknown constant. But otherwise, every other constant is known. And that's the beauty of making a simple approximation, get a very compact formula, which guide us comparing with the experiment. This is reaction rate, which can be related to size of the palladium trapping potential, palladium size. This is size of a palladium nanoparticle or microparticle. So the prediction goes like this. Well, if you look at the formula, there is no gamma factor involved. Although if I apply same technique to two-body system in a free space, I do get the gamma factor. But when I use n-body solution, wave function, then I do not get gamma factor in it. So this solves essentially the first observation that the Coulomb barrier is suppressed. So the Bose-Einstein atomic, the nuclear Bose-Einstein condensation can suppress Coulomb barrier. That's first important point. Incidentally, this is consistent with the Dirac conjecture, which was made in his book, in this chapter. What he noticed is that if number of bosons are very large in the system, then the creation annihilation operator can be treated as a simple number, which means that charged boson, if you have many of them in the system, it behaves like an independent particle in a common average background potential, and the Coulomb interaction between two charged bosons is essentially suppressed. Now, this was a direct conjecture, and our results are consistent with his conjecture. So now, for a single track, like 5 nanometer palladium particle containing N deuterium, what will happen is that initially you form the condensate state, and then it can, two of them go to helium 4 by a nuclear process, but energy is shared by all of them, so that all of the particle, if n is very large, gonna get on the average very small energy. It's all shared by all final state particles. And so this will explain observation two, that one can have a nuclear process producing helium without the gamma rays. So the momentum conservation is obviously kept. Now, incidentally, the two-body process, two deuterium, DD Huygen, is probably prominent one, but 3D, 4D Huygen are possible because the Coulomb barrier is suppressed now. But the probability of forming 3D, 4D Huygen are probably much less compared to 2D. But keep in mind, this is possibility. Now, the total momentum conservation shows that the one has to have a zero total momentum conservation initially, finally. So finally, one would be sharing all of the Q bar used by N particles. So this would be kind of average kinetic energy. So the more deuterium you have in this condensate state, each of them get the less energy. And this could lead to a hotspot, because each nano microparticle is doing it. And if heat is enough, it will explode, creating a crater, and it looks like a firework explosion. So that's consistent with the observation right here. And furthermore, let's say the lower charged particle flying out of this condensate will lose energy by electrons and so on, so it will create X-ray, gamma ray, and Bremsstrom, depending upon what this average energy are. So that will explain observation six. Now, there's one additional theoretical work we have to involve, and that is the selection rule for two species case. We will be using a mean field theory of a quantum system, Hartree-Fock, this is misspelled, Hartree-Fock theory. And if you consider two system in the same trapping potential, one can work it out mean field energy functional. This comes of a standard Hartree-Fock theory, which is written in this way. And eventually you end up with a time-independent mean field equation shown here, where W is the interaction term, and mu is the chemical potential. And if we make another approximation, so-called Thomas Fermi approximation, where you ignore kinetic energy term in this equation, if you drop this term, one can see that this holds. Now, whether this approximation is appropriate or not, if the system is in a low kinetic energy regime, probably this approximation becomes very accurate. And we are in a low energy regime. Okay, thank you. Anyway, there is a selection rule, and this says that the selection rule doesn't work for these two channels, whereas selection rule works for this channel, so that one can explain observation number five, that is channel four or five is much weaker than channel six. And that has to do with later I'll talk about impurity. And of course, another possibility is that many of the this reaction as well as other reaction can go through this reaction, which will create a neutron with a maximum energy of about 18 MeV. And then one can have this one as well. The tritium coming from here can do that, so that creating another neutron. And there are other neutron, those neutron created from this process can do this as well as that, and eventually do this, which is what the Navy group has reported. There are additional mechanisms based upon quantum statistical physics, and because time is short, I won't go into this, but there is a new effect due to non-Maxwellian distribution for the interacting plasma, like our case. And so there's a new physics evolving here. It doesn't follow this line for this particular case. So there will be some new physics about this, but because time is short, I don't going to. And this can be explained because those, even if you switch off the experiment, these are dynamical system. Deuterium have been moving, and then they will do so at the thermal condition so that it will continue and eventually die off. And this is very important observation that the flux deuterium mobility is required for this theory as well as the experimental observation. And then purity is that selection rule. If I have a small amount of hydrogen, that prevent the formation of BEC state, and you won't see the our effect, and so on. I like to, at least I like to go to one final point. There are lots of predictions this makes, and we have to do all of this experiment to improve a theory and eventually achieving, after we understand, one can achieve 100% reproducibility. So it's important to really test out this theory. But there are one fundamental experiment one can do, and that is to see whether nuclear Bose-Einstein condensation state can exist in the metal. One can go to high pressure, like diamond anvil device, schematically shown here, and then compress this sample. And if you apply electric current, sudden change in resistivity is expected when Bose-Einstein condensation occurs. So this is a signature one would look. And then radiation might come off because of fusion, which we can look. And another possibility is use a laser beam to see whether there is a Raman scattering frequency shift. So those are signature one can look for, see whether there are nuclear Bose-Einstein condensation happening. So this is conclusion and summary. This theory seemed to provide consistent conventional theoretical description of result of many experimental work studied by Freshman Pons in 1989 and by many, many others, some of which are reported here since then. Experimental test is predict proposed, and then we need to carry out the experiment to see whether both Einstein condensation indeed can be proven as a basic fundamental phenomena, and then we really need to understand theory more completely so that we can achieve 100% reproducibility. So I say to experimentalists, there are lots of work, I want you to do it to see whether this theory holds up or not. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We now, according to this clock, are 5 until 5 o'clock. Actually, we're about 8 till 5. So let me recommend that we take half the break time that we'd intended and reconvene here at 5 o'clock in 8 minutes. Please come back. I know we're going late, but we have 3 very exciting talks yet ahead of us. And so please definitely reconvene here at 5 o'clock. And this will give a chance to stretch our legs and take care of necessities.